as you all looking into the topic, you may think I'm going to explain the dynamic behavior of a bridge or building with some complex formulas, those things. No, I'm not going to do like that. I'm just going to share my knowledge on the present current industry practice, how they are computing the dynamic loads, and how they are using that loads to design a structural element. Okay. These are the contents for today's webinar. First, let me introduce, do some introduction on what are the dynamic loads which I am going to talk about here. Then I will share some why the dynamic analysis is required. Then how the dynamic loads are estimated, both seismic and impact loads. Then I will share you how the current industry practice, and followed by the career path and job opportunities. Introduction. Here I'm going to talk about bridges and buildings, where in bridges, the two dynamic loads will be subjected. The first one is seismic force, which is due to the ground movement. The second one is due to the impact load, due to the moving loads, because the bridge is usually subjected to the moving loads due to the vehicles. So due to that, the impact load will be there. If you see the images shown below, both the bridges, the left side is the bridge, is like a deck being supported over two pier or two column. If you see the left side image, and the right side is the building one. Both will be subjected to seismic force, that is due to the ground movement. When the ground moves, the structure, due to the gravity load, it will restrain, so that horizontal force will be acted on the structure. This is seismic force. I think all of you are aware of it. Same in the building also. But in case of the impact load due to the moving load, if you see the orange color, this is the static position of the wheel load. Due to the static position, the beam or a deck will deform. But when the load moves, due to the moving, there will be an additional impact load will be created. Due to that the beam will deform much. So that the deformation is much means the beam will be subjected to additional bending, shear. So those things we need to consider in our design. So these are the things we are going to talk about here. Then let us see why a dynamic analysis is required. First, let us classify like two things. One is the impact load, which is due to the moving load. The second one is seismic load. So first I'll share you why the dynamic analysis is required for computing the impact load. In case of a bridge, consider a bridge. As I mentioned earlier, when the wheels are in static position, the beam will deflect with some bending moment, shear, and stresses in the extreme fiber will be something like this shown here. But when the vehicle moves, the beam will be subjected to additional deformation due to the impact loads and some additional reaction, bending, stresses in the extreme fiber. So that we need to compute, and we need to design the structural element for that one. So this is why the dynamic behavior is important, and this we need to compute in our design so that the structure element will not fail. The next one is seismic force. Here we are going to I'm going to share you about why the seismic force is required, should be considered in a design. Let us take two towers. The left side is a tower with only gravity load. The right side, the tower with gravity load and a horizontal force, which is created due to seismic force, due to the ground movement. You see, only due to the gravity load, the stresses in the extreme fiber of this tower pier will be Fy and Fcu. Maybe a certain value. But when it is subjected to a horizontal force, there will be some additional bending, those things will be happening. Even though the density or the intensity of the horizontal load is less when compared to the vertical gravity load, but this horizontal load case will govern our design. So it is very, very important to consider a member by satisfying all these seismic force, impact force. Now let us see how we are estimating the impact load for bridges. What usually we will do is the impact load, how we will do is provision of impact action shall be made by an increment of vehicle load by a percentage of static vehicular load. What we will do is we will just increase the vehicle load, static vehicle load, by some percentage. in order to contribute for the impact this one. So in case of a bridge, there are two types of bridges. As you all know, the bridge is used for crossing any river or any obstruction at the grade. So we will propose a bridge there. So the bridge will carry both traffic, highway traffic like vehicle, car, bus, trucks, those things. The second one is like rail bridges. Rail bridges is like metro rails, normal railway bridges, high-speed trains, those things. For impact load, for finding impact load, for highway bridges, it is straightforward. We need to only consider, find the impact load, in the impact load, and we need to apply it in our analysis and design the structure for it. But in case of railway bridge, there is another component addition to the impact load, that is deck acceleration. Why we want to consider the deck acceleration is because the rail bridge is running over a track, the rail track. So the rail track, because the rail, since it is running over the rail track, the rail will be, when it is running, it will be subjected to some vibration, deck vibration, due to this impact load. And the passenger inside should be comfort, because they should not be subjected to this vibration. So there is a limit in the code so that the deck acceleration should be limited to that value so that the passenger inside can have a comfort journey. And one more thing, since the rail is running on the track, so in any case, it should not dislodge from the track. So also the deck should not accelerate much so that the train may dislodge from the track. So this also need to be viewed. Now let us see how the highway bridge, the impact load has been computed. Highway load, the impact factor may vary based on these parameters. The left side shown is class A, class B, class AA, class 70 are as the vehicle types. Based on the vehicle type, the impact factor varies. The other component is span of the bridge. Based on the span of the bridge, the impact factor varies. And based on the material of the bridge, this material is mainly the superstructure material. Based on the material change, the impact factor varies. Okay. For a highway bridge, you might have seen there are many types of vehicles at present in the current market. But we cannot design for all those types of vehicles for our bridge. So what the code has been given is they have provided some four types of vehicle which will give a governing result for all these kinds of vehicle. So if you design our bridge for these four types of vehicle, then our bridge will satisfy for the impact factor for all these kinds of loads. For this webinar, I'm just focusing on the Indian code. If you see here, I'm following IRC 006/2017 as a reference. In this code, these four types of vehicles are being specified. But this is Indian code. The different national code has different sets of vehicle types. So for example, like United Kingdom's Kingdom, UK British standard, they have different types of vehicle, HA, HB, those things. Euro code, they have different type. ASTO code, American code, they have different type. So for this webinar, I'm just focusing only on the Indian code. Okay, these are the four vehicle types. Then if you see this one will give the impact factor. The impact factor, as I mentioned earlier, it varies based on the vehicle type. The second one is span. The third one is material type. So if you see this graph here, it shows for class A and class B. If you go to the earlier slide, it shows four types of vehicle for class A or class B, class AA or class 70. So for class A and class B, this is the graph. So the vehicle configuration is like that. The right hand side, if you see, class A is the wheel configuration is like this, and class B, the wheel configuration is like this. And for those two things, the impact factor, the magenta color shows the curve for steel bridges and blue color shows the curve for concrete bridges. So based on the span, we can find what is the impact factor percentage. So if you see, if the span is less, the impact factor is very high. And the span goes, when span is higher, the impact factor reduces. That is because if you see this one, you consider two columns of same dimension, the diameter circular column with the diameter D, but the height of column is different, and apply a horizontal force at the top of the pier, at the top of the column, P1, same for both column. But since the height is different, both column stiffness is different. So the shorter column will be more rigid and attract more force. So the bending will be higher in the shorter column. But in case of longer column, the stiffness is less. It will attract less less force. So that is the same reason why here small span has higher impact factor and larger span has smaller impact factor. So this is the main difference. Now this graph shows for Class A and Class B vehicle. The next one shows for Class AA and Class 70R. Here they are classified like this. This is the right side shown is the wheel configuration. Class 70R, this is the wheel configuration. And the bottom one shows Class AA wheel configuration. So here they classified as for span less than 9 meter for tracked vehicle, it is 25% for span up to 5 meter. When it and linearly varying by 10% for span up to 9 meter. And for wheeled vehicle, it is 25%. Something like this they classified. And for RCC bridge and steel bridge, it is like this. So for in this class 70 here also, they have wheeled track, wheeled one and tracked one. So both the wheel configuration is different. So based on this, we can compute the impact factor. This is how we will find the impact factor for highway bridge. Now let us see how the dynamic factor has been computed for a railway bridge. For a railway bridge, it is not straightforward. We will use we will perform a dynamic analysis in order to get both the impact factor and, as I mentioned earlier, the deck acceleration. The deck acceleration also we will found based on the dynamic analysis. Okay. Now, you may think why for a highway bridge it is straightforward. We are just referring to some graph and we are getting the impact factor and we are considering that one in our analysis and design development. But in case of railway bridge, we need to perform additional analysis like dynamic analysis, and then we need to get the dynamic factor, and then we need to go for the other process, because the railway bridges are subject to, because railway bridges are running on track and it is subject to these three major behavior. The first one is the brutal entry of train on the bridge creates a free vibration resulting from the inertia of the span that cannot instantly accelerate to the deflection corresponding to the position of force. Because the train is moving and the deflection cannot match with the position of the vehicle. So the deck will be oscillating. So this is the main cause, the first one. The second point is, at high speed, they're regularly axled, because in case of a highway bridge, the axle is not regularly spaced. But in case of a train or a high speed anything, the axle means the wheel position. The wheel positions are regularly spaced. So this will excite and may match with the natural frequency of the bridge. As you know, if it match with the natural frequency, the resonance effect will create. So this one we need to avoid. So for this also, we need to perform a dynamic analysis. The third one is track irregularity creates additional dynamic effect. Because if you see, when we are designing, we may consider the track is laid perfectly without any deviation. But practically, it is not possible. They may have some tolerance in construction. So there may be certain irregularity in the track position. So that one may create additional impact factor. So that one also we can compute through dynamic analysis. Thus, the Eurocode, what Eurocode suggests is, because here I cannot refer to an Indian code, because the Indian code does not give any speculations or specifications how to perform a dynamic analysis. So I am referring to Eurocode. So the Eurocode, but the method is similar. I'm not going to going very detailed to the loadings or those things. I'm going to share you about how the process is going to be done. So what they are mentioning is, when the speed is less than 200 kilometer, the dynamic analysis is not required. They have given like a straightaway formula to compute the factor. But if the speed is more than 200 kilometer per hour, they ask us to perform a dynamic analysis to find the impact factor and deck acceleration. Then the next one, the principal factors which influences dynamic behavior. These are all the factors. When these are all the variables, let me say that, put it this way. These are all the variables. When it varies, the dynamic factor and deck acceleration varies. The first one, the speed. As the speed increases, the dynamic behavior, dynamic factor will increase actually. When the span increases, as I shown earlier in the graph, it plays a major role. The dynamic factor varies. Then the mass, then the natural frequency of the whole structure, the axial configuration, maybe the axial load, the wheel load. If the wheel load varies, the dynamic factor varies. If the spacing of the each wheel varies, the dynamic load varies. Then the damping of structure. When the dampness of structure for RC, the dampness is less, the steel, the dampness is more. So based on that also, the dynamic factor varies. Then the vehicle configuration, the vehicle imperfection, those things contribute. If you see the right side of the table, this will give you a better picture. If you see the bridge parameter, the first column is the bridge parameter. The second one is the resonance speed. And third one is the maximum acceleration. What they are mentioning is if the damping of the bridge increases, there will be no effect in resonance. But the deck acceleration decreases. If the damping increases, deck acceleration may decrease. The second case is, second scenario is, if the mass of the bridge increases, the resonance will decrease with square root of m. But and at the same time, the maximum acceleration also decreases. The third parameter, the stiffness of the bridge. If the stiffness of parameter increases, of the bridge increases, the resonance will increase with the square root of the stiffness. And the maximum declaration, there is no effect. The fourth one is product of mass and stiffness. Both, if it increases, the resonance will have no effect, but the deck acceleration decreases. This is like a general overview, because when we perform an analysis, getting the value from a software or something, we need to know whether whatever the input is correct or whether the output is correct or not. So based on this, we can find, by doing some trial and error or something, we can get an idea whether the output coming from a software is correct or not. Next, requirement for performing a dynamic analysis. What are the requirements which the Eurocode specifying to perform a dynamic analysis? Here, they have given a flowchart. So this flowchart, don't worry, don't go into detail. Let me explain briefly how they have set up this one. So if you start this one, if the speed of the train is less than 200 kilometer, then yes, if it is yes, then we need to go check whether the bridge is continuous or not. If it is continuous, then dynamic analysis is not required. Then we can use the one static formula to compute the dynamic factor. But if it is not a continuous bridge, then we need to refer this graph, this chart, and we need to check whether there are natural frequencies within these two upper bound and lower bound. If it is within that, then also the dynamic analysis is not required. But if it is outside that, then the dynamic analysis is required. This is for case less than 200 kilometer. If the strain speed is more than 200 kilometer, then if it is a simple structure, span greater than 40 meter, then the dynamic analysis is not required. We need to use this table. But if it is a simple structure, it's continuous or something, then the dynamic analysis is required. Something like this. It's a process is like this. But anyway is the condition, we can perform a dynamic analysis. Because getting a dynamic analysis instead of using the formula will give you an economical design. Because the dynamic factor plays with many parameters. So if one parameter changes, everything will change. Because in a particular project, there will not be a same span for throughout the entire length. A particular project, let us say 1 kilometer bridge is there. It may not have only 30 meter span, multiples of 30 meter span. It may have 20 meter span, 30 meter span to overcome some obstructions underneath the road. So it is like that. So if for each span, the dynamic factor varies. So if you can compute each span, the dynamic factor, and apply it in your design and design the structure means, then it will be an economical design. Instead of doing for a maximum case or a minimum case, something like that, and averaging it, may overlook sometimes, it may happen. So it is better to do a dynamic analysis for any case, for any kind of span in a particular project.